Professor Warner Woodworth, thank you for accepting this interview. I have some questions for you. First one is, do you think the poverty is a global problem or only regional?
Well, I think poverty is both a global problem and regional. Global in the sense that there are extremely poor people in every country in the world. On the good side, or the good news, is that it's less than it used to be. Massive world poverty has been on decline for about 30 years. But still we have pockets of huge and terrible poverty, especially in parts of Asia and parts of Africa. And so I believe that in some regions and some countries, there's still massive amounts of poverty. And those people are worse off now in many cases than they were 10, 20, 30 years ago, because conditions are so bad, and the ghettos and villages that are so packed into these big cities, people have no jobs, and there's dirty water, and they can't get access to medical care. And so in some countries, poverty is much worse than it used to be.
My second question is it possible to say there's a relation between globalization, new world order, and poverty?
I think so. I think there's been while the rhetoric has been positive about globalization and new world order, and we passed through World War I and World War II and the Cold War to some extent, the process of globalization means that big governments and big international orders like the World Bank or the IMF or the UN and big corporations in Europe and the Americas have created jobs for many people around the globe, but they've also sucked out much of the natural resources, the minerals, the oil, the agricultural products from those countries, and benefited the rich in the developed world, not so much to help the poor in the underdeveloped world. And so we need a healthier, more equitable, more just world order that benefits everyone rather than just a few elites.
My other question is, does the Western world really censor while fighting with poverty again?
I think a lot of people are very sincere. A lot of big institutions that fight poverty are committed to it. They want to see more justice. They're a bit uncomfortable with the disparity between haves and have-nots in society. And yet, you also see, at least in my experience, many institutions fighting poverty run by staffs, by CEOs, by boards of directors, by technocrats, who they're part of an industry. And for 10, 20, 30 years, they live a very good life. They fly to Africa from Europe or the US in first class. And they're picked up at the airport in a limousine. They're driven to an expensive hotel, $500 or $1,000 a night. They eat expensive meals. They meet to discuss the plight of the poor. And you don't get the feeling there's empathy. It's become kind of a business. And they get in their limos and they drive out to the village and they meet with the village elders or the chiefs or the women's leaders. And they say, we're so sorry, we're here to help you. Trust us, we'll take care of you. And then they get back in their vehicles and go back to their palace, go back to the Congress, go back to their government offices. And they don't have the impact they could have. They have much more potential they could be doing, but they kind of like that lifestyle and that big salary. And they don't see the contradiction between that and a person who's living on $1 or $1.50 a day in those villages. So I think there's a lot that can be done with churches, with governments, with NGOs to practice what they preach.
My last question for you, Professor Warner, is what is your suggestion on fighting poverty on micro and micro? macro base?
Well, I think fighting poverty on the micro base, we've had this fantastic new strategy called microfinance, microcredit, micro lending to the poorest. And it is a huge success. From about 10 million people who could get a micro loan 20 years ago to today, about 500 million people can access a micro loan. And with that little $100, $200 loan, that woman is able to create a little business and begin to move herself out of poverty with her children and have resources to send the children to school, have financing so that she can afford to go to a doctor when the child is sick. And so microcredit has become a very successful strategy for helping the poor help themselves, not being dependent on USAID or the World Bank, but being able to make change happen themselves and moving towards self-reliance. So I think microcredit, social entrepreneurship, social business, those are wonderful methodologies at the micro level to reduce poverty. At the macro level, I think we need massive redistribution of wealth among the richest companies and richest people on the planet. We have a handful of families that own 40% of the world's wealth. That's immoral, that's unethical, it's unjust, and I think we need a strategy, if not charity, if not them being willing to share their resources and seeing the contradiction in how they live and how billions of others live. Then we need to pass laws, we need governments to be involved, we need companies to create new policies that cap the wealth the CEO and the top executives can receive on an annual basis, so that we don't have companies where the top managers receive 300 or 400 times what the lowest paid full-time employees in their firms receive. And I think other tools are the creation of worker cooperatives or worker-owned enterprises, ESOPs, employee stock ownership plans, which in the U.S. now there's about 10,000 companies like that with about 10 million workers, where workers own the business they go to work at, and they get shares of stock, and they get dividends on that stock, as well as their regular salary and benefits. And so these forms of worker ownership reduce the levels of poverty and inequality, and they give workers a second source of income for their future. So that helps them have more sustainable futures.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.